Let's welcome our reader for today, Bob Santum.
So I was going to say, good morning, Faith Church. My name is Bob Santum. I'm delighted to be with you here this morning. Here we are, folks online, this fifth Sunday of Lent. Also referred to as Passion Sunday, and it was around the time that Jesus raised Lazarus from the dead after being dead for 4 days. We want to welcome our first time or returned visitors this morning. We sincerely hope that you enjoy your time with us here today. We also want to welcome those of you who are online. Please give us a thumbs up or leave a comment so we can know that you're worshiping here with us today. If you use Facebook, please check in so that you can let your friends know that you are here at our worship services at Faith Church. And here are some quick reminders of what's taking place in the life of Faith Church. We have our quilt raffle to support sisters in faith in their community outreach projects. Tickets are online, are on sale in the Narthex on your way in and on your way out. Don't miss out on this. The drawing is next Sunday, so make sure that you see about getting your ticket for that quilt on your way out today if you haven't done so already. Bible study continues to be held each Wednesday at 10 a.m., both in person and online. And I don't know if you noticed anything different in the church today, but has anyone ever seen Donna Pecco paint? She's like a whirlwind, and she doesn't make a mess. Donna and I and Ed Hesser and Michael, are you here? Michael, we came in on Friday or Thursday and Friday, and painted everything in here except the ceiling and this front wall. But Donna is like through with this whole side over here, and I'm only halfway down this wall. So when Donna says she loves to paint, she must. I really don't care for it much myself. But. This is a message just for the kids. We have a game night coming up on Friday, April the 19th from 6 to 7:30. Kids are reminded to bring their families and their friends. And depending on the attendees' ages, parents are asked to attend and enjoy board games, pizza, face painting, and fun with them. Some of the older kids, however, they've kind of indicated that parent involvement might not be that necessary. So you better check with them first. See Miss Marlene on your way out today and pick up one of these flyers and reserve the date. Enjoyment books are available today also in the Narthex. Those books will only be sold through the end of March. So you only have today and the next two Sundays to pick yours up. And speaking of the next 2 weeks, you'll want to mark your calendars for our Holy Week services here at Faith Church. Palm Sunday service will be held on March 24th at 10 a.m. Our Good Friday service will be on March 29th at 7 p.m. And Easter Sunday service will be on March 31st at 10 a.m. with an Easter egg scramble to follow services. If you have not witnessed our kids gathering up 900 plus Easter eggs in less than a minute and a half, you're in for a real treat. Remember to stock up and keep with you some church business cards to invite a friend or even a total stranger to Faith Church. This week we say happy birthday to Lee. Lee Hicks is, your birthday is this very day, March 17th, St. Patty's Day today. 90. See, you shouldn't have told everybody. I was just going to say from where I'm sitting, that day was about 30 or 40 years ago. We would like to encourage everyone to take a look at our weekly newsletter. where you can find the details of these announcements, as well as the monthly summary of our church's year-to-date income and expenses. There are connection cards for the church that are in the seat back of the chairs in front of you. So if you have a prayer request, if you require a pastoral visit or would like to receive the church's newsletter, or if you just simply want to share any changes in your contact information, you can fill one out and leave it in the offering plate by the door at the end of service today. For those of you who are in the front rows, who don't have any seat backs with those cards in front, or if you're sitting someplace else that there's no seat backs in front of you, just yell out your requests and your changes and I'll try to remember them for you. If you haven't already done so, please place your cell phones on silent mode, unlike me, who after I read the announcements containing this very same request during the Ash Wednesday evening service at the beginning of Lent, I received a very loud phone call right in the middle of Pastor's sermon, at which time Pastor Rob kind of looked down at me there and said, you know, there was just an announcement about this a couple minutes ago. To which I sheepishly responded, I guess I didn't hear it. So don't be like Bob. Silence your phones. Now let us remember who we are here at Faith Church. Our mission is to love God, to love one another, and to love our community. Our call to worship this morning is taken from the Gospels. In the book of John, chapter 12, verse 32, Jesus said, "When I am lifted up, I will draw all people to myself." All people. Blessed be the God of our salvation, who bears our burdens and forgives our sins. Let us stand together this morning as we worship the God of our salvation.
Truth. your servant Moses, righteousness being restored. And though these are days of great trial, of famine and darkness and sore, still we are the voice in the desert crying, prepare ye the way of the Lord.
Welcome our faith kids and youth that are here with us today. Glad that you're here. And today's story is going to be about the triumphal entry of Jesus. Let's watch our video.
The story of Easter, the triumphal entry. This is Jesus.
Heyo!
Who is the Son of God and the Savior of the world. While Jesus was on earth, he taught everyone about God's love and healed people from their sickness. He did many miracles like calming storms and even raised people from the dead.
Wahoo!
At this time, the Jewish people were celebrating a festival called Passover that had been celebrated since the time of Moses, when God brought his people out of Egypt. So Jesus was going to Jerusalem to celebrate. Jesus and his disciples stopped in a town.
You're coming?
And Jesus told two of his disciples to go on ahead of them.
Okay.
He told them to go into a village and that they would see a young donkey. that no one had ever ridden.
Rock!
He told them to untie it and bring it to him. If anyone asks, what are you doing? He told them to just say, the Lord needs it and will return it soon.
Okay, go ahead.
So the disciples did what Jesus said and brought him the donkey. A long time ago, before Jesus was even born, God had said that the Savior, the King of Israel, would come to Israel in this way. And now Jesus was doing just as God had said. The news that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem swept through the city. Many heard about all the amazing things he had done, so they cut palm branches and ran to see him.
Huh?
The Pharisees and religious rulers realized that there was nothing they could do, for everyone was going to see Jesus. Jesus rode into the city of Jerusalem, and the crowd spread their coats on the road ahead of him. His followers began to shout and sing as they walked along, praising God for all the wonderful miracles they had seen. The Pharisees were upset.
Hey, Jesus!
And they told Jesus to stop the people from saying things like that. But Jesus said, if they keep quiet, the stones along the road would burst into cheers. So the people kept on singing, blessings on the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Praise God in highest heaven. The entire city of Jerusalem was in an uproar as he entered, asking, who is this? And the crowds replied, it's Jesus. And Jesus rode the donkey through the street of Jerusalem to the temple in a triumphal entry, just as God said he would many years before.
Let's pray. Jesus, we're so glad that you are King in our lives, and we welcome you into our hearts today. Be with us as we study this story today in Sunday school, we pray in your name. Amen. Our faith kids and youth are invited to make their way to Sunday school as we sing this song. And then afterwards, you can remain seated as we prepare our hearts for the sermon.
Joy we share is with none other has ever known. He speaks, and the sound of his voice is so sweet, the birds hush their singing, and the melody that he gave to me within my heart is ringing. And he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own. And the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever stay in the garden with him. Though the night all around me is falling, but he bids me go through the voice of woe. His voice to me is calling, and he tells me I am his own. And the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known. None other has ever known.
I love that song. And you sang it beautifully. Today's reading, scripture reading, is from the book of Jeremiah, chapter 31, verses 31 through 34. The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah. It will not be like the covenant that I made with their ancestors when I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, a covenant that they broke, though I was their husband, says the Lord. But this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my law within them. I will write it on their hearts, and I will be their God. And they shall be my people. No longer shall they teach one another to say to each other, know the Lord. For they shall all know me, from the least of them to the greatest, says the Lord. For I will forgive their iniquity and remember their sin no more. May God provide us with a special blessing in his word this day.
Let's pray. Holy God, by the cross and resurrection of Jesus, you lift the suffering world toward hope and transformation, and you open the way to eternal life. As we move ever closer to the passion of Christ, may your law of love be written on our hearts as he draws all people to himself, revealing your love for the world. We bring to you today the joys and the concerns of our hearts. We give you thanks for the gifts that you've given us, and we take a moment to lift up those for whom we've made special requests for prayer this week. God, we know deep within our hearts that by the power of your loving presence, you're able to accomplish abundantly far more than we can ask or imagine. Your word, O God, has power to change our lives and to create a whole new world. As we meditate on your word this day, fill us with your Holy Spirit that we may treasure your word with our whole lives and fix our eyes on you. Amen. Today we talk about this new covenant that we read in the book of Jeremiah the prophet. So part of being human is kind of figuring out what this life is all about. And this is kind of a gradual process for us. Some of us kind of start to catch on a little bit earlier maybe than others. There are different things that we become aware of. We become of the tremendous joys and blessings that this life has to offer, and we also ponder life's mysteries and deal with life's sorrows. Sometimes when I've talked about this process of growing up, I say things like, that stage in your life when life gives you a really hard kick, that's kind of when you start to learn a little bit more about what's going on. But it's not just about those parts, but it's also about the wonderful things of life, like falling in love for the first time or just being awed by nature or the things around us. That's something that everybody goes through, no matter who they are as a person. We're kind of have this opportunity to wake up to the reality of life. But there's something else that's also described within the scriptures and within the traditions that we follow, and that is that there is something else going on that not everybody catches on to, and that is there is a way for us to connect with the life giver, the creator, and the sustainer of all this. There is a way for us to have a special relationship with God as we go through this life. And it is something that has been termed many different things. One of the terms that we use in Christianity and that is used in Judaism as well is this term covenant. This word covenant is not really something that we hear about a lot these days. You may hear about them. I don't know, your covenant with your homeowners association, which really doesn't carry the most positive connotation. Maybe it is a serious contract that is written up between parties. Way, way back in the day, where this term came from, where it originated thousands of years ago, had to do with kings and people in the area. Something called, I think it's called a suzerain treaty. It's a treaty that's made between a king and the people that have been conquered by the king. And essentially, at the very beginning, it's a promise that's made that the king will protect you and you will pay taxes to the king. And it's an arrangement that in some ways we still have today. We are promised protection and security and we just have to pay for it in our own way. So this is kind of the origins of this idea of covenant. And then as people of faith started to kind of wake up and realize, there is a covenant agreement that supersedes and is far beyond any covenant that people can make between one another. And it might be similar in that God is the ruler of all, of everything. And God is the protector of all and everything. And if we follow in the promises that God makes for us, God promises life and protection and prosperity in our lives, and we just need to pay with our time, with our effort, with our heart, and with our devotion. So covenant has been around for a very long time. We may say that this started with our father in faith, Abraham, when God shows up and has a conversation that says, I want to make a promise to you that I'll bless you, and your descendants will grow and be like the stars of the sky and the sands of the sea. And this blessing will continue on with your children's children's children, and it will change the world. And I will be your God, and you will be my people. And they made a covenant at this time. And if you go back and read the story of this covenant, to show the severity, the seriousness of this covenant, it was kind of what we would call a barbaric practice, which was taking animals and cutting them in half and walking down the middle back and forth. And so blood has always been an integral part of this covenant. And we're saying that we have nothing more precious that we can give as our devotion than the blood of our lives. The blood represents the essence of the life force and who we are. So we share a blood covenant, starting with Abraham and God, and then we can see it. We use the same terms in the Last Supper and when we take communion. It is the cup of the new covenant in my blood that Jesus talks about when he raises the glass of wine for everyone to drink. And so covenant is a serious business. It is a connection that we have with our God. And it is a relationship. And it is something that we read about today in the book of Jeremiah. The book of Jeremiah talks about an old covenant and a new covenant. It talks about a covenant that we believe as Christians was fulfilled and brought to some type of culmination with the person of Jesus Christ. It's a covenant that we are a part of today. If we are followers of God, we have entered into these promises, this contract with God. And so today we're going to take a few moments and look at the nature of this covenant relationship that we share with our God. One of the things that's discussed in Jeremiah is that this covenant is a continuing covenant. It passes from one generation to the next. And so this is one of the reasons why churches have had a practice of baptizing their young, is that this is a sign of the covenant being passed on to our children. In the time of Jesus, what they would do with their children is take them to the temple on the eighth day, and the male children would be circumcised. And this was a sign, a symbol, again with blood and with something very serious. This is a continuation of this covenant passed on from one generation to the next. And so we don't go through that particular practice as Christians, but we use baptism, and the scripture talks about how baptism is the new sign and symbol of this covenant. And so we pass this on from one generation to the next. This text here says, this was a covenant that God made with our ancestors, one generation to the next. We talk about generations a lot. We can see articles in newspapers a lot. One of the most recent ones that I saw is that there is the greatest transfer of wealth is taking place today, as boomers are passing on their wealth to generations that are coming afterwards. And it's something like, I remember reading the number, and the number that stuck in my head, I can't tell you if that's the right number, but I want to say it was $90 trillion. That just sounds like too much, but maybe the boomers have too much money. I don't know. But there's a in this article I was reading, there's a chart that shows how if you look at all the generations that are alive today, you have the silent generation, the boomer generation, the X generation, the millennials. There are some after that, but it only included those four. And in this chart, in this table, you can see that this half of all the wealth that is out there today is owned by boomers. And then all the other generations collectively share the other half. So there is this transfer of wealth taking place with property and with stocks and with estates and with all in all types of ways, wealth being passed from one generation to the next. So we're aware of generations. We're aware of, usually when we have conversations about generations, we talk about our differences, how one generation is so different from the next. We may talk about the millennial generation, and as we're talking about them, we're just kind of making faces when we're talking about this generation, this entitled generation that just thinks weirdly and differently, and they just don't have the same ethics, the work ethic, and the, I don't know what we did wrong, but we have these millennial generation. And but, you know, this attitude is probably the same attitude that every single generation before us had about the young ones, the kids that were coming. It's an attitude that somebody had about you at some point, maybe still has about you and your generation, the previous generation thought. But isn't it interesting how God forms a covenant relationship with each and every generation, and it doesn't matter if those generations are similar or they are very different. God is able to connect with us where we are. Maybe God is able to use our particularities and our special gifts and the things that we are dealing with as a current generation in a way that God wasn't able to with the last. You know, there is a generation presently and in the future that will deal with artificial intelligence. And how does God connect with artificial intelligence? How is this integrated into our lives? How is faith and spirituality impacted by artificial intelligence? There may come a time when you don't need a person to stand in front of you to give a sermon, but you just, I guess, hit play and ChatGPT will give you a sermon for the week and will know exactly what you need to hear. But that's something those kids will have to worry about that are oncoming. God connects with each and every generation and helps us to work through the particular challenges that we face. You know, the silent generation was the generation before the boomers, the generation that grew up within the age of the Depression, saw a couple world wars, and their experience was very, very different from the grandkids or the kids of the boomer generation that also saw wars, but the wars were very different. And God connects with us wherever we need him. There are other places within the scripture that talk about how this covenant is an eternal covenant. And it's interesting to think about that, because what that would mean, you know, eternity really doesn't have anything to do with space and time, but it has to do with this reality that always is. That means that covenant and God's relationship with creation has always been there. Even before creation, it was still in God's heart. And it's something that is very important to God and that we should take seriously because of that. So it is a continuing covenant from one generation to the next. How many of you are grateful for the generation that came before you and what they passed on to you in their faith journey? They gave us a foundation with which to build our own faith journey. And so many people, that may have been a mother, a father, it may have been an uncle, an aunt, it could be a neighbor, a church member. Sometimes we even have random relationships that just kind of come out of nowhere. And so grateful that we have people to pass things on to us, that we can pass on to others, this continuing relationship. It is an encompassing relationship. It means it started with Abraham, with one person, and it has grown exponentially, and it has taken root in so many lives. Can you imagine having a conversation with Abraham and talking to him about what life is like today and how many people are around today and how many people have been touched by his faith story? To see the work of God, you know, it in some ways it seems like Abraham is forever ago, but if you just count generations, it's really not that long ago in the scheme of things that Abraham was around. And for this covenant to grow as much as it did is just amazing. This scripture here uses this phrase. It says, "They shall all know me." And that is the purpose of this covenant relationship. It's not just for Abraham and Abraham's people, but it is, you know, when Jesus comes on the scene and they start to talk about how covenant is passed on with followers of Jesus and with followers of the faith, we find out that everyone is included in the family of Abraham through the power of the Holy Spirit. Thank God it's not through a DNA test. Thank God for us in this world, in this room, because if it were for a DNA test that included us within the covenant of God, guess what? We'd be out of luck. I mean, there may be a couple of you that maybe you know or you don't know that you're related through DNA to Abraham, but we find out through the message of the Holy Spirit to the Apostle Paul after Jesus comes on the scene that this covenant is open to everyone. And so that's why you see Christianity explode around the world, because this message of covenant being open to everyone is something that was included. This is the same text, this Jeremiah text, is the text that they quoted on the day of Pentecost when the Holy Spirit was outpoured on all these people and they began to be filled with the Spirit of God. They looked back and said, ah, this is what Jeremiah was talking about, this new covenant where everyone knows God, and this is for everyone, for all people. Sometimes we think about, like, all the Christian denominations that are out there. If you just, on your way to church, you can probably count how many churches you pass before you pull into the parking lot of Faith Church. And there's a whole lot just right here on this corner as you drive in. And many times we may look at that with disappointment and say, why can't we be more unified and don't we have more in common? If you look it up, there's, I think, more than 40,000 Christian denominations, not churches, denominations in the world today. And that is a lot of division. That's a lot of disagreement. But another way to look at this is that we're each holding on to something very special and something very unique, and there are ways for us to all connect with God, and maybe this diversity of denominations is some of the ways that God is moving to make sure that all people get a chance to know me. Now, we can invite all of Port St. Lucie to come to worship with us here at Faith Church and give them that opportunity, and we should make that effort. But you know, not everybody's gonna come the first time, and not everybody's gonna come the second or the third time. It's gonna click with some people, and it's gonna be a wow! I can't believe I found you. My home was right here, right under my nose, and I didn't realize it. But then others may be like, not in a million years am I gonna go to Faith Church for whatever reason. We have very different tastes and needs in our faith journey. So thank God that there are so many different opportunities for people to connect with God. If it's not through our family, our faith family, it's through another. This is an evolving covenant. It means that we are deeply transformed in this relationship that we have. This is described with relational terms in the book of Jeremiah. Here we see God say that I was their husband. I was their husband, talking about his relationship with Judah and with Israel. Using this term of intimacy and personal connectedness when he says that I had a relationship with them. It talks about how this new covenant is something that takes place within us, not just around us, not just in a rule book that you have, you know, with everything written down or maybe written on the walls, but this is something that takes place within us. This covenant relationship, it says, I'll put my laws in their hearts and within them. And then it says that we will know the Lord. And this word to know is another word that talks about intimacy. We're close with God. God knows us better than we can be known by anyone. And we can know God. And I know that's something that is hard for us to grasp, but just as we can know another person, think about the people in your life that you know best. You really know them. Maybe they can be sitting next to you and you can tell just by the look on their face what they're thinking. You're like, this isn't good. This is not good. Something's happening. Or you can be like, what is she laughing? I know what she's laughing about. We can know one another when we're in intimate relationships with one another. This is what God wants for us. Not just that God knows us. We can buy into that. We can say, of course God knows me. God created me. But it goes the other way around too. That means God wants us to know him, to have a personal relationship with God. When we go throughout our day, to have a sense, I can feel God's up to something. I bet I know what God's going to do. And I think that that's what God wants for us. And that is a part of this covenant relationship. And this evolving, deepening relationship with God in covenant is something we can spend our whole lives working toward. It is work. How many know that your closest relationship take a lot of work? Amen? Even the ones that are our favorites, that are the closest to us, they take work. It's no different with God. It takes work for us to be in relationship with God. I'll share this. This is just for me to get it off my chest. So occasionally I'll come in on a Sunday morning and there's just a weird feeling inside of me. You know, it's not a peaceful, energetic something. It's almost like one of my favorite movies growing up is Star Wars, and there's this phrase, I can sense a disturbance in the force. You know, it's something like that. And I can't tell, who knows what that is. You know, I slept with a new pillow last night. So, you know, that could be it. When I came in, my brother Jay tells me that his wife Janet passed away yesterday. And Jay, you've been here at Faith Church for, 5 or 6 years? You've been coming every, you know, Jay lives here and he lives up north as well. And we won't hold that against you, Jay. But when you're here, you're with us, and Jay's in Bible study. We have wonderful conversations about God, and I feel a kinship with Jay because he has such a unique spiritual journey and very eclectic, but led by the Holy Spirit. And so I'm inspired in this relationship. And when we were starting this service, and you told me that Janet passed yesterday, I thought maybe that's it. Maybe that's it. Maybe there's just something that doesn't, something feels off. The frequency is recalibrating, whatever that may be. And our prayers are with you, Jay, and our love is with you. But this deepening relationship that we have with God, it's something that allows us to understand more about our days as they go on, to figure out what is that feeling that I'm having inside of me. This relationship that deepens and transforms us, it helps us to go through things that we never thought that we would go through. Has anybody ever gone through something you never thought you would go through? Of course. And I don't want to say it out loud, but I bet we're going to go through something else that we never thought we were going to go through. And Yeah, I don't want to say it out loud. I don't want to jinx it. But I mean, come on. We know God. We know this life. And that doesn't, how many of us know that sometimes the stuff that we never thought that we would go through, that we really, if we look back, we didn't like that season of our life. But how many of us can say, I learned more. I changed more. I have been transformed more through that experience than anything else. Then do we know God, that this is the way that God works? It's crazy. You read the Apostle Paul, and Paul would say things like, I count it a blessing when I face trials and tribulations. I rejoice in my suffering. And we're like, Paul, dude, more therapy for you, Paul. What is wrong with you? Rejoice in your sufferings. That is not normal. That is weird. But maybe Paul knew God. Paul knew God so well that it's like, it's not like, here we go, but it's like, here we go. Somehow. This is a deepening relationship. And one of my favorite phrases that Paul uses is this one, where he says, it's no longer I who live, but it's Christ who lives in me. And that talks about the depth of this covenant relationship that ends up replacing me with Christ. It's no longer me. It's no longer I that goes through this life and through this day and on into eternity. It's Christ here that goes on. That's so transformative that we cease to be me, and it is Christ within us. And then we have these words, we'll end with this. This is a covenant that is freely available. It is for everyone, and it's freely available for you to enter the first time in your life. Maybe some of us have memories of the first time that we really entered into a covenant relationship with God. Or maybe the first time we kind of woke up and realized the depth of this reality of our relationship with God. And then it tells us that we are free to re-enter this relationship with God, because there is a phrase in here that says there was a covenant that was broken. And it's never on God's part. God never, ever has given up on us. But it is always us coming back to God. There's a prophet, and I think it is Hosea. Tell me if I'm right. He's married to a woman of the night whose name was Gomer. And I'm not making this up. Just like Gomer Pyle, her name was Gomer. And God told Hosea, if it's not Hosea, it's another prophet that begins with H that has a little book there in the scripture. And God says, I want you to marry Gomer, and I know what she does for a living, but I want you to marry her. And then, and he does. And then he experiences the rockiness of this relationship. It was not the most stable of relationships, because she kept coming and going into this relationship. And her kids, who's her kids? Were they Hosea's? Were they somebody else's? And then God goes on to say, like, you see, Hosea, this is what I have to deal with you guys. You guys, Israel and Judah, you're Gomer, and I'm Hosea, and I don't leave you, and I keep taking you back every single time because I just love you too much. And I understand, you know, I understand that sometimes you're here with me, and that I understand that sometimes you're not. But you can always re-enter your covenant relationship with me. Now, I don't, you know, this is not something that if you went to your marriage therapist, they would not, probably not encourage you to have a relationship like this. They'd probably say, you need to leave that woman and move on with your life. But God wants to show us the openness of this covenant relationship. That's why he says, I'll forgive your iniquity and remember your sin no more. Forgiveness is baked into the covenant. Are you glad that forgiveness is baked into your covenant relationships with one another? Because if you didn't have forgiveness baked into your relationship with one another, you wouldn't have a relationship for very long, would we? Because we need forgiveness to keep it going. We have to practice forgiveness. It's the oil of the engine, and without the oil, that thing is going to blow up. We need forgiveness. It's baked into the old covenant. It's baked into the new covenant. We need forgiveness. And I don't know if you've experienced this before, but sometimes when we forgive one another, it actually strengthens the relationship that we had. A relationship that's gone on for a long, long time and there's been no need for forgiveness, I don't know that I would trust that when the winds blow and when adversity comes. But those relationships where we have admitted our faults, we've asked for forgiveness, we've shared our brokenness with one another, we've given one another second chances, we've built and rebuilt our trust, this is what we have in our relationship with God, in our covenant relationship with God. We have the blessing of promises in our relationship with God. God takes his relationship with us seriously. And hopefully we take ours with God seriously as well. What we see in the cross is a reflection of who God, of the God that we are in this covenant relationship with. It is a reminder of all that God is willing to do for us, to give everything for us, to go through anything for us. And God simply wants us to be willing to do the same in our relationship with God. Let us be thankful and grateful for this covenant that God offers to us. And let us be open to a new and a fresh understanding and even maybe commitment to our covenant relationship as we continue through this Lenten season and on to the celebration of resurrection and new life coming on Easter morning. Let's meditate on these words. You can remain seated as we sing.
You're all I've ever needed.
Today, let's remember any announcements or sign-ups that may help us engage in the life of the church this week. And we can turn in our connection cards or offerings in the plate by the door. Let's pray. As the high priest Melchizedek blessed Abraham and offered his tithe of bread and wine at your holy altar, may our gifts be made perfect through Christ to glorify you and bless the world. We pray in the name of the one who taught us to pray, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Let's stand for a closing song.
May the Lord bless you and keep you.
May the Lord bless you and keep you.
May the Lord make his face to shine on you.
May the Lord make his face to shine on you.
And be gracious to you.
And be gracious to you.
May the Lord lift his countenance on 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 you.
May he keep you in
God, whose hand has written the law of love on your heart, fill you with peace and deep within in the commitment to live in harmony. And the blessing of God who loves, forgives, and calls us home be with you now and always. Amen. Let's go in peace.